Well, good evening and welcome to Harlem Week's celebration of the 106th mayor and our friend,
David Norman Dinkins.
This lovely lady is Debbie B.
And this young man is G. Keith Alexander.
Thank you. I just want to tell you a quick story about our friend David Dinkins. Back in August of 88, I wanted to get married to a principal dancer with the Alvin Ailey American Dance Company. And she was on her way to Europe, but I had 2 or 3 days before she left so I could get married, so I didn't know what to do. So I called David, and he was the city clerk at the time. And I said, David, I want to get married, but I don't know what to do. He says, I tell you what, come down to my office on Monday. This was on a Thursday. Come down to my office on a Monday at 10:30. Do you have a rabbi? I said, no. He said, do you have a priest? I said, no. He said, do you have a judge? I said, no. He said, don't worry about it. I'll take care of it. Monday, then he says, oh, but wait a minute. He says, at 10:30, I've got Coretta Scott King and Betty Shabazz scheduled. You know what? I'll reschedule them. And I felt so honored, you know, I mean, cheese and crackers. So I get down there at 10:30, and he's got the judge, and he's got the camera crew from Fox 5. So I'll forever be indebted to David Dinkins, our friend, for setting me up like that for my wedding.
Congratulations to you. And my little story is that Hal Jackson, he's my late husband, he and I were doing the Sunday Classics on 107.5 WBLS. And when he was running for mayor, he came, and it was such a joy to have him in a studio with us. It was him, Jesse Jackson, and who else was in there with us? Al Sharpton. But I mean, it was the Sunday Classics that was able to introduce him to a lot of people in New York, and I'm sure that he was forever indebted to us. But now, let's keep this program moving. And first we have some words of inspiration that's going to come to us from the Reverend Jacques DeGraff. He's the pastor of Canaan Baptist Church.
Good evening, family.
Good evening.
Did you hear that she said Canaan Baptist Church? Then we can do better than that. Good evening, family.
Good evening.
Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Harlem Week is about faith. Back in the day when we started, Harlem was a ghetto. They called it a slum. The nicest thing people said about Harlem, they would say, we're going uptown. But Lloyd Williams and his team had a dream, and they stepped out on faith. Well, faith is what Dave Dinkins is all about. Because life, on too many occasions, knocked Dave Dinkins down, denied him on so many occasions, and he was counted out. But Dave Dinkins stayed with his faith, and he was undergirded by the prayers and the votes of the people of Harlem. Did you hear that? You. When others counted him out, Harlem counted him in. And on that faith, he stands today. And we stand today because that faith is alive and has been translated into power. And Eric Adams was here earlier this evening. Harry Belafonte used to tell the story of 1992 when the Olympics was in Atlanta and they had the greatest relay team of all time. Alvin Bragg, each person on that team was a world record holder. But they failed to win the gold because they failed to pass the baton. Well, the spirit of Dave Dinkins today helped us to pass the baton in New York City. The spirit of Dave Dinkins today lives in each of our hearts, and it will live in City Hall once again come this November. Dave Dinkins had a lot to say about a lot of things, but he always stood on the right side of justice. And so at a time when our vote is under threat, when our churches are under assault, and when COVID has been plaguing our communities and our eyes are still filled with tears, we remember a man who stood against injustice. They called him everything but a child of God. But we called on our God to protect him and to guide him, and his legacy is what brings us here together. And so as we go out into the night and as you hear from these gifted speakers in this hallowed hall, remember one thing, that David Dinkins never stopped believing, and Harlem never stopped praying. And together, we made it sure, we laid a foundation that the best would be yet to come. And we're living proof this evening, as God is our witness, that the best has come for David N. Dinkins, who was home with the ancestors. God bless you, and good night.
So I've had a chance backstage to meet the executive director of the Schomburg, and I'd like to now bring her out and introduce her to you. Please put your hands together and welcome the executive director, Ms. Joy Bivens.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture. It is my absolute delight and honor to join you this evening for this very special event to raise in tribute the larger-than-life presence of the Honorable David N. Dinkins. As the first Black mayor of America's metropolis, New York City, his legacy and impact resonates particularly with me. You see, I grew up on the south side of Chicago, a city whose first Black mayor, the Honorable Harold Washington, remains a spiritual presence and inspiration even decades after his passing. And no doubt that will be the legacy of Mayor Dinkins. As you all know, the Schomburg Center collects, preserves, and exhibits the vast richness of Black cultures and history, everything from the early narratives of formerly enslaved people, the papers of Dr. Maya Angelou and literary giant James Baldwin, to the memorabilia of hip-hop icon Fab Five Freddy. And I'm happy to share that thanks to the assistance of the Dinkins family, Linda Hamilton, and the mayor himself, we now have select items that represent his remarkable life added to our archive. Friends, I also have something else that gives me great joy to share with you tonight. This is the first public event at the Schomburg Center, at which I have the honor of welcoming you, our esteemed guests, as the center's new director. And I stand before you with great humility at taking this mantle for this esteemed institution, but also as the first woman to lead the historic institution since the retirement. Thank you. Of the legendary Jean Blackwell Hudson in 1980. So I have big shoes to fill here. I want to welcome you to our home in Harlem. I am so glad that you are here, especially given what we've experienced in the last year and a half. Some of us did not make it, but yet we sit here tonight. So thank you for supporting the Schomburg Center, and thank you for joining us tonight to honor the life of David Dinkins. I wish you good health, be well, enjoy this evening, and again, thank you.
Hi. I went back and I thought about it and I said, you know what? It was Al Sharpton that was in the studio with us. And it is my esteemed pleasure now to introduce you to the Reverend Al Sharpton.
Thank you first to Lloyd Williams and to all of those at the Harlem Chamber that makes Harlem Week so sensational. When you think of David Dinkins, not only was he historic, But he was a man that you really would have had to know to understand the greatness of Dave Dinkins. I first met him when I was a teenager, and Bishop Washington, who was my pastor, introduced me to him and told me that this man is the city clerk. I was a teenager. He told Mr. Dinkins I was a boy preacher and he should show me some things. So Dave Dinkins invited me to lunch. And I went to the municipal building and went up. His secretary brought me in. He said, let's go. And we went down the elevator and walked a couple of blocks. And he brought me to a vegetarian restaurant. And we had salad. And in them days, I was not a salad eater. And he shared stories and inspiration that you would tell a kid that wants to be something. And we walked back to his office, and I got back on the number 2 train and went to Brownsville. And my mother said, did you go? She was so excited. I said, yeah. I went. He says, how was it? I said, it was very good. She says, well, tell me about it. I said, well, it was very good. He was very kind. He got a big office and secretaries. I said, well, he's a strange guy. She said, why do you say that? I said, he eats grass for breakfast. But as the years went on, when I started National Youth Movement at 16, after the breakup of Operation Breadbasket, Dave Dinkins was my lawyer that incorporated us. And every step of the way, even when we would get on him unjustifiably as we matured, he never broke his relationship with activism. As we prepare now to fight for voting rights, many of us are marching in Washington August 28th, let's not forget that Charlie Rangel and them were marching in Selma to get the Voting Rights Act. And a lot of our young people think they invented activism. Dave Dinkins and Charlie Rangel and others. In 1984, when Jesse Jackson ran for president, when Barack Obama was just a student at Columbia, and most black politicians went with Walter Mondale, Dave Dinkins and Basil Patterson went with Jesse Jackson. And then in 1989, when everyone thought Ed Koch would be renominated for mayor, and Charlie Rangel and Percy Sutton and Basil convinced Dave Dinkins to run, and he ran. Bensonhurst happened that summer, and people began to see the ugly veil of racism in the North when people stood out there throwing watermelons at us as we marched for justice for Yusuf Hawkins. Dave Dinkins turned that into political power and became the first black mayor of this city. But one of the things I want to raise is 10 years later, 1999, we were at a pre-fight reception near Madison Square Garden. Don King was having some fight. And in the middle of the time, at that time, we were protesting the police killing of a young African immigrant called Amadou Diallo. And we had started this strategy of going down to One Police Plaza and sitting down in front of the plaza and going to jail every day. We started with 8 or 9 a day. By the time we got to the fifth day, it was about 150 or 200. And I remember at this reception, I went into the restroom, and Charlie Rangel came in the restroom, and Charlie Rangel was then a senior member of Congress, chair of House Ways and Means, and he said, I've been watching you on television. He said, look like your numbers are growing. I said, yeah. He says, would it help if I come down and get arrested? I said, you'd come down and get arrested? He said, what time do y'all go? I said, about 10 in the morning. He said, well, I don't get the shuttle to Washington till about noon. He says, I'll come down at 10, and I think it would be good for them to see someone like me go to jail with y'all. So I left the bathroom. I knew my generation, we all were friends, but we'd be competing, Alvin. You know, it's always competitive friends. David Patterson and Greg Meeks and I were boys and always tried to outdo each other who was going to be in the paper the next day. But I didn't know that the generation ahead of us was like that. Dave Dinkins pulled me to the side and said, Charlie's going to jail tomorrow? I said, that's what he said. He said, that's interesting. He said, how long do they keep y'all? I said, hour or two. He said, I think I'll come down. I said, you'd go get arrested? We're going in front of One Police Plaza where you were the mayor over there. He said, but I think this is wrong and we have to do something about policing. When he was mayor, he started community policing. When he was mayor. When he was mayor, he had the most violent demonstration that we saw before the insurrection January 6th was when the police marched on Dinkins City Hall, led by Rudy Giuliani, who led a violent insurrection. I'm not telling the DA anything to tilt evidence either way. I'm just talking history. And about 5 to 10 the next morning, Dave Dinkins and Charlie Rangel got out of a car and walked in front of One Police Plaza. And way before we ever heard the name of Colin Kaepernick, they took a knee against police brutality. And and as Dave Dinkins was on that knee, I will never forget, a policeman walked over to us getting ready to cuff us. And they said, Mr. Mayor, if we'll take you out the back through the lobby, you were mayor, we don't want to cuff you and bring you out with the rest. He said, no, I'm going with Charlie and Al, cuff me. And he made them cuff him. And people saw around the world, this gladiator, this mayor, who had all the prestige, would not take down and wanted the world to know that even though he reached great heights, he was still a man that would fight for the people. That's why Harlem Week would not have been Harlem Week if we did not support and remember and extol the legacy of a man who was not only our first black mayor, he taught us how to be a mayor and black at the same time. Some politicians become elected and go mainstream, and they go black to mainstream. Dave Dinkins made mainstream come black, and that's why we love David Norman Dinkins.
I'd like to acknowledge Lloyd Williams, the president and CEO of the Greater Harlem Chamber of Commerce, and all of the event organizers and participants who have made Harlem Week and this celebration of Mayor Dinkins possible. Columbia University is proud to be one of the sponsors of Harlem Week, and proud, of course, to be part of the community of Harlem with its long and rich history that stretches back generations. Harlem Week is such an essential part of the fabric of the neighborhood. It's an international celebration of the culture, the businesses, and the people that make Harlem unique and extraordinary. Thank you for inviting me to take part in this annual event and in this tribute to David Dinkins. It is an honor to join you today as we gather to celebrate the life of an extraordinarily talented and thoughtful public servant. The Honorable David N. Dinkins was an elected official of uncommon grace and integrity who spent his career serving the people of New York. As a member of the New York State Assembly, president of the New York City Board of Elections, city clerk, president of the Borough of Manhattan, and of course, as the 106th mayor of the city of New York. To his friends, family, and loved ones, my wife Jean and I send our heartfelt condolences for the irreplaceable loss of Mayor Dinkins and his wife, Joyce.
David Dinkins was a warrior for justice and equality. He faced a lot of obstacles in his career, but he kept fighting. He never gave up. He lost his assembly seat. He was elected to the assembly, lost the seat because of redistricting, but he didn't give up. He was really committed to public service. So he found other ways to be helpful. He had a tax problem, and that prevented him from becoming the first Black deputy mayor. But again, he didn't give up. He found other ways to serve. And then the first time he ran for borough president, he lost. But then he ran again, and he won, and he served with distinction. When he decided he wanted to be the first Black mayor, there were many obstacles. People said, you couldn't do that. It's never been done. But he said it was important that the Black community have the leadership that it had been denied. And he won. He inspired us. He encouraged us. He made it possible for us to have all kinds of positions that we had never had before. David Dinkins was a man who was committed to public service, to uplifting people, to use the power of politics and government to enrich the lives of people in New York. We're blessed and we're grateful that we knew him, that he served us. Let's keep alive always the memories of David Dinkins. And whenever things get tough for us, remember, David Dinkins says, never give up, keep trying.
Everyone, it's a pleasure to join you in this tribute to the life and legacy of David Dinkins. I wish I was there in person to celebrate with you. But listen, I want to thank the Greater Harlem Chamber of Commerce for putting together this event. We cannot say enough good about David Dinkins. We honor a giant of New York City politics and government and life, and a man who got his start in public service right in Harlem, and he never forgot where he came from. And Mayor Dinkins made things happen in this city, and he did it because he loved the people of this city. He had a signature phrase, we all remember, the gorgeous mosaic. That's actually how he saw New York City. He saw the humanity, the beauty of New York City, and it moved him. He saw all the communities, all the cultures that came together to make this place amazing, and he wanted to lift everyone up, and that's what he did. He did it with big ideas. Some consider them bold at the time, but they were the right thing to do, and he really doesn't get the credit he deserves. We became a safer city because David Dinkins started us on the path with the Safe Streets, Safe City program. All the legend of how New York City turned around. He is the one who started the ball rolling. He is the one who started so much of the affordable housing being built that people benefit from to this day. He's the one who cared so deeply about our children. You spent time around him when he was with kids. He loved being with children, and he did something about it. The Beacon programs, the after-school programs that are alive and well to this day, helping thousands and thousands of kids. That was his idea. It's alive and making a difference now. What he started decades ago matters to us to this day, and he believed that this could be a fairer, more just place. And he started us on that road, and he inspired so many of us. There are so many people in public service today because David Dinkins helped show us the path. I'm one of them. I got my start here in the life of this city, in the work of this city, through David Dinkins. He literally helped me to have the family I have. I literally wouldn't have met my wife, wouldn't have gotten married, wouldn't have the family I love so much without him, because Shirlane and I served together in City Hall. That's where it all began. So, for so many of us, even though we know he's left us physically, he hasn't left our hearts or our minds. He hasn't stopped inspiring us. His mission continues. It's up to all of us now to carry on and to do what he would often say, which is keep the faith. To keep the faith in each other, to keep the faith in the city, keep the faith that we can bring the city back after COVID stronger than ever, better than ever. He always kept the faith. Now we need to keep the faith. And we can do that together. And that is the way to remember and to honor David Dinkins. We're going to keep building that gorgeous mosaic together. Thank you for honoring him, everyone. God bless you all.
David N. Dinkins, mayor of the city of New York. He will always be the mayor of the city of New York to me, and to so many in the village of Harlem. I'm grateful to have had that opportunity, to have had small time alone time with him and Congressman Rangel together when we rode in the car for the African American Day Parade, where I had an opportunity to listen to the man, to listen to Mayor Dinkins tell about the things that he envisioned years ago, the disappointments that he felt he had experienced, and his vision moving forward. I felt that made me special. He used to call me his cousin. And although we were not cousins by blood, indeed, we were family. And I'm grateful to Joyce, and I'm grateful to the Dinkins family for allowing the city to have him. They shared him. This was a phenomenal thinker that thought way ahead of his time. And I'm grateful to this family for allowing us to have just that. He will be sorely missed. He was a great thinker, a great man, and he always took time for every individual. Thank you to the Dinkins family for the opportunity for all of us.
Ironically, my fondest memory of Mayor Dinkins is my last memory of him. It occurred on August 10th, 2019, when he married my wife, Mary, and myself. I asked him to perform the wedding, but I knew he was in very poor health at the time. So I told him that, you know, he could just do a real quick oath and we would be done. Instead, Mayor Dinkins comes back with a long questionnaire that each of us had to answer in front of all of our guests. I thought I was in front of a grand jury. And finally, I said to him, you know, considering the fact that this was difficult for you to do, why did you decide to make it such a long ceremony? He said, since you're both getting married the second time, I wanted to make sure you were absolutely sure. We had a great laugh about that. Among the many things, I worked for him as his fundraiser in 1985 when he ran for borough president, and I worked in his campaign in 1981. And I remember him all the way back to his being my dad's law partner back in the early 70s. He was a wonderful man, and this city is going to miss him more than it ever knows yet.
Ladies and gentlemen, the governor of New York is here tonight. I'm talking about David Alexander Patterson, the 55th governor of New York. Please give him a big round of applause. Hello there, governor.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. You know, the Schaumburg now has its first woman leader, and the state of New York is about to have its first woman leader. And I've been hearing about these things that have been going on about sexual harassment of women and toxic work environment and failure to answer subpoenas. And when I hear about the things going on in Albany now, I think my Yankees tickets are looking pretty good. To the Greater Harlem Chamber of Commerce and Lloyd Williams and all of you who have worked so hard to put this event together this evening for David Dinkins, we thank you because we lost him a number of months ago and we have all wanted to have that opportunity to have some kind of public event to just encapsulate all he did for us and all he did for everyone, whether they be Asian, Black, Hispanic, or white, whether they were upper middle class or welfare recipients, whether they were tenants, landlords, cooperators, or even the homeless. His rare combination of skills uplifted everybody in this city. So, I just want to set the record straight about his epitaph and how it is misplaced and misrepresented in the city. You hear people talk about the 80s and the crime, and now it's starting to look like the 80s again when Dinkins was the mayor. In fact, David Dinkins was not mayor of the city for one second of the decade of the 80s. He became mayor on January 1st, 1990. In the first 2 years of his service, there were over 22,000 people being killed in the city every year. By the last 2 years, he had cut the crime by 25%. He also issued his Safe Streets, Safe Cities Act and brought 6,000 new police officers into New York. But by the time they got there, the mayor who took credit for it, I won't even mention his name. Then there's the issue about the deficit. David Dinkins is the only mayor of New York City to ever leave service with a budget surplus. There were $600 million that he left in that budget. And I just think that at this time, his service, his civility, his rare combination of skills, his ability to bring people together is being recognized, and he is being given the proper, just the valuation that he gave to the city of New York. It was my honor to be his friend and to help him. Now, Carl McCall mentioned something that I thought was really interesting when he spoke on camera. He said that David Dinkins lost his assembly seat to a reapportionment in 1965. Now, when David Dinkins ran in 1965, this great partnership of Percy Sutton, Basil Paterson, David Dinkins, and Charles Rangel, they're treated almost like they were quadruplets, like they were all born together, they were always friends. No, they used to fight and argue the same way Meeks and Sharpton and I used to. And we were supporting someone else for the assembly, a man named Franz Leichter. And so we were taking David Dinkins' posters down. I was 11 years old, and I did that. Never told the mayor years later that I did that, but I did that. And Leichter wins. And then one day my parents were talking, and they said something about, and David's joining the firm in 2 weeks. I'm like, who? He said, yeah, David Dinkins is going to become my law partner. I'm like, what, him? That's the guy we were tearing his posters down. And my father was trying to explain to me that after elections, you work together in politics. He didn't think I was getting the message, so he had David Dinkins call me. I was like 17 years old. He said, just want you to know I'm working with your dad now. So, but that's the warm and loquacious way that David treated everybody, and we are so honored. And the one thing David Dinkins also was the champion as at attending everyone else's events. He came to everything. And I'm not surprised if in a few minutes we open the door and he's gonna walk in here right now and speak and recognize everybody in the room. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Letitia James, Attorney General of the great state of New York. And I want to lend my voice to the chorus of individuals celebrating a great man. New Yorkers owe David Dinkins a profound debt of gratitude for leading us through a crisis. New York City in the early 90s was a city battling rising crime, rampant homelessness, and a deep recession. David Dinkins didn't cast blame or seek to divide us. On Inauguration Day, he simply put his Sunday best on, laid his hand on the Bible, and told us that we were a gorgeous mosaic. David Dinkins was a gorgeous mosaic of a man. He was brilliant. He was inspiring, caring, and decent. He was a man of great faith, a man of love. He cared about others, particularly children, and he cared about his city. He took time to do things right and always found time to do the right thing. David Dinkins made history and made this city and this world better than he found it. David Dinkins has been the beacon lighting my path from my first run for city council to my campaigns for public advocate and attorney general. I was honored to have him hold the Bible at my inaugurations because I stand on his shoulders. I know so many who feel the same way. And now he rests with his beautiful bride, Joyce, in the realm of the Almighty. May they rest together in peace and in power and in love.
You know, when I think about David, I think about all the times that we spent together. And for me, knowing all the things that he's done, all the things that he's accomplished, you know, the most important thing for me is that he was a real gentleman. You know, so many things and so many people do so many things, and the way they do it, it leaves a little bit to be desired. But David was always on point, and he always made me feel like whatever I was thinking about, whatever I was about at that time, he was concerned. And for me, he's always been the people's champion. And you could always see that sparkle in his eye when we talked about tennis, and I talked about that big forehand that he had. Well, he was that kind of a guy, and I'll miss him.
I first met Mayor Dinkins when he was city clerk, and he joined the National Women's Political Caucus. Men were allowed to be members, and he attended our meetings. We were always delighted when he showed up. Fast forward to 1990. Mayor Dinkins is Mayor Dinkins. When Bill Lynch became deputy mayor and offered me the job as director of the federal office in New York City, I took it, and I learned more in 4 years than I have since, and I made lifelong friends in the Dinkins administration. I went to the city office in Washington, D.C. for budget bill markups. We brought large city mayors to a summit on urban issues at Gracie Mansion, and we forced city agencies to apply for all discretionary federal grants, bringing in $90 million in 1 year. As a Manhattan Borough President, I am housed in the David N. Dinkins Municipal Building at 1 Center Street. And on July 10, 2019, Mayor Dinkins turned 92, and we celebrated his birthday with hundreds of his friends and former colleagues in his previous office, the office of the Manhattan Borough President. Because of the pandemic, it was his last public birthday celebration honoring him. I have many, many wonderful memories of Mayor Dinkins. I also had the pleasure of seeing him on the political circuit at breakfast and dinners, even after he was supposedly retired. He was always so kind to me. He taught at Columbia University with many of my interns, and they said they loved the course because there were so many guest speakers who were world renowned. Thank you, Lloyd Williams and Harlem Week, for celebrating Mayor David Dinkins with this tribute.
Hello, I'm Michael Pugh, President and CEO of Carver Bank. I'm honored to salute David Dinkins. The Honorable David Dinkins will forever be known for his leadership and loyalty to the community, particularly Harlem. Among his many accomplishments, he will be forever appreciated for his contribution to Carver Federal Savings Bank as a board director and advocate for wealth building in Black communities. He is legendary for his treatment of others with a level of respect and appreciation for diversity. He famously referred to New York City's demographic diversity as a gorgeous mosaic. Mr. Dinkins, we salute you and know that your spirit remains with us.
Hello, my name is Rodney Capel. I'm Vice President for Charter Communications. It's our great honor to be a sponsor for this great event. I want to thank Lloyd Williams and the Greater Harlem Chamber for hosting this tremendous honor on behalf of our great mayor, Honorable David N. Dinkins. Mayor Dinkins was a huge impact on my life. First man I ever voted for, first person I ever worked for. When my father died, he spoke at his funeral. When I got married, he came and attended and gave his blessing. So it's a blessing for me to be able to share this opportunity to highlight the life that he lived and the impact that he had, not just on myself, but the entire city of New York. And so on behalf of the family here at Charter Communications, Spectrum News, we want to thank the life well-lived of David N. Dinkins, my favorite mayor.
You know, one of my fondest memories of Mayor David Dinkins was us sitting together at one of our meetings. We both were part of a group called the Beverly Club. And he and I, you know, would talk about a range of things. But this one day he said, you're a newly elected senator, you know, great track record, love what you did on the community board, you served the community, you went to Brown and Harvard, all of these great things. But just know any one moment can bring this all crashing down. And, you know, one of the things you need to do is be kind to your staff, be kind to the constituents, be someone who's a person of integrity, speak with honesty. That's something I've always tried to do. People can always disagree with you on an issue, but you want them to respect you as a person. And I've kept that with me to this very day. And I just, you know, I miss him. I miss his elegance. I miss his class. I miss his calm, steady presence. I'm glad that he's going to get his just due and be honored, because he's done so many great things for the city, not just as a mayor, but as a human being, as an individual. And I'm proud that I got the opportunity to know him when I did.
Well, Debbie and I, we were going to do a duet right about now. However, there's a young man who's in the house tonight. His name is Elijah Ahmed Lewis, and I've seen him play Stevie Wonder in the play Motown. I've seen him performing in Mama, I Wanna Sing from the Mama Foundation. And ladies and gentlemen, he is going to come out tonight, and you're going to have a real treat, because he's going to sing from the play Ain't Too Proud. He's going to sing Ain't Too Proud, I Wish It Would Rain, and The Way You Do the Things You Do. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for this Broadway phenomenon, Elijah Ahmed Lewis.
This October, the Tony-winning sensation returns.
I can turn the gray sky blue.
Oh, I Ain't Too Proud, the life and times of the Temptations.
But my life is incomplete, I'm so blue, cause I...
The smash hit musical with the Tony-winning moves and the Grammy-winning songs returns to Broadway this October. For tickets, visit telecharge.com.
Hello, everybody. Oh, we could do better than that. We're Harlem. Hello, everybody. As I like to call Uncle G. Keith has stated, most people know me from Mama, I Wanna Sing, playing the Minister of Music, and also being a vocal instructor and musical director for the Mama Foundation for the Arts, which is the School of Gospel, Jazz, and R&B Arts, which is spearheaded, and executive directed by Harlem's own Vi Higginson. Yes. This is a full circle moment for me, because all of our concerts used to be right here on the stage. I performed on the stage since the tender age of 11. So to come back and to pay homage to Mayor Dinkins is quite amazing. So I'm going to give these two selections. Make sure you has anyone seen Ain't Too Proud? We are making a triumphant comeback to Broadway on October 16th, and I hope to see you there. Come on, put your hands together.
You got a smile so bright. You know you could have been a candle. I'm holding you so tight. You know you could have been a handle. The way you swept me off my feet. You know you could have been a broom. The way you smell so sweet. You can be an hour. Oh, the way you stole
This next song, please put your hands together for Kenny Seymour, who is our musical director for Ain't Too Proud.
Five guys, one dream. At long last, they're together again and back on Broadway.
Ain't Too Proud, babe, sweet darling.
Ain't Too Proud, the triumphant Temptations musical with the Tony-winning moves and the Grammy-winning songs, returns to Broadway this October. Tickets are on sale now, so get ready, because here they come.
Ain't Too Proud. Come on, let's give them all another round of applause. Ain't Too Proud. They will be back on Broadway October 16th, so make sure you get your tickets and keep Black Broadway alive. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce to some and, of course, to welcome back to Harlem, as always. She's always around. She's the past national president of the NAACP and a woman with great strength and courage. None other than Miss Hazel Dukes.
Good evening, family. Amen. When I was interviewed early this evening, I said it was an emotional night for me. 3 decades of friendship, being Dukes of Nassau, being the sister of Charlie and Percy, being the daughter of Basil Patterson. had the privilege to be in the first African American in the United States of America to hold a position as president of New York City Off-Track Betting Corporation. Had the privilege to walk in a room where Donald Trump had been the head of the racing and casino industry, and when I walked in, dressed to the nine, looking like a queen. He wanted to know who I was, and I said, I'm Hazel Dukes, president of New York City Off-Track Betting, appointed by Mayor David N. Dinkins, and asked that he remove himself from the seat he was sitting in so I could take the seat. That's the Donald Trump I know. I won't call the other guy's name. You've heard several people talk about safe streets, safe city. This little black girl from Alabama was the person that distributed the money on Safe Street, Safe City because of David N. Dinkins. As a board member of the Greater Harlem Chamber of Commerce, I started off with Jacques DeGraff and Jewel McCabe coming to my office talking about a Harlem day, something like that. And I remember going to see David with Basil driving Charlie and myself to the hospital. You remember that, Congressman Ringer? That Saturday that we almost had an accident with David, that Basil was angry because we were late. We had gone somewhere with Inez, and we were late coming back. And Basil was our driver and was going to leave us. And he had flowers, and we didn't have anything. We're going to the hospital to visit David. And we got there, and I never called her Joyce. I always called her Miss D. We got there, Miss D, and the children was there. And of course, you know Charlie Ringer. He went in loud. All the staff came out because Congressman Ringer was there and Basil Patterson was there. So this little girl trailing behind him. But when Mayor Dinkins saw me, he dismissed the two guys. He said, my sister is here. And so we had a time together with him. I knew the night that Mean Giuliani was elected. First thing he said, he wanted the Dinkins out of the mansion before 12 midnight. I moved from Nassau County to East 68th Street in the Rudin Building because Basil Patterson decided that I could not stay in the NAACP houses because the Post, if they are here tonight, would write about me. So I had to be in a building with my own contract, with my own light bill in my name, own everything. So they called Rudin, and I moved to East 68th Street. And I was the only black person there. Charlie knows this story. One day a lady came down and said to me, do you have another day's work? And I said, no, I don't, but I'm looking for someone myself. But when Giuliani said that the Dinkins had to move, I called them up. I said, nobody is here but me in East 68th Street that looks like me. I said, come on. Well, they did come. I left them and moved to Harlem. But David, I served as his secretary as he was the chair of the Council of Black Elected Democrats. We would bring them out to Nassau in Mary Murphy's yard, and we would have barbecue. You know, they were all from the city. So they was very excited when we would bring them out every year to have it. So many memories, as Reverend Sharpton talked about, David and the people that he cared for. David loved people. He loved children. When he got ready to run for mayor, he had no police protection. So the late James Jim Bell was the driver, and I was the security guard. We picked David up every morning. Miss D would have him dressed to the nine, and we would leave. That mean Bill Lynch. I had popcorn for breakfast, popcorn for lunch, and popcorn for dinner. And when we would deliver Mr. Dinkins back home in the evening, Jim Bell and I, just the two of us, the room that we had at 1199 wasn't as large as this flower pot. Ken Sunshine will tell the rest of that story. But when Lloyd Williams said to us as a board that because of COVID-19, and I called Congressman Rangel, and we both shed tears and cried that morning, that we could not give David what we would wanted him to have had, neither for Mrs. D. It is so fitting tonight that you and of Harlem, this place would have been running over if it wasn't for COVID-19. Lloyd had to, and the board had to do some turning around even to get you in here tonight. As early as Monday, he thought we would have to even cut it down more because of this. But it's so fitting tonight that we stop and pay tribute to a husband, a son, a father, a lover of his people, the late David Norma Dinkins. Rest in peace, Mr. and Mrs. Dinkins.
I will never forget in 1999 when police had killed an unarmed man named Amadou Diallo, and we started probably the greatest consistent wave of civil disobedience America had seen in protesting the unarmed killing. Former mayor then, Dave Dinkins, saw me at an event, and he said, "I've been watching you guys the last 3 or 4 days going to jail, maybe started with 10, got up to 50. He said, "I want to go." I said, "You want to do what?" He says, "I want to go down and take a knee and sit in front of One Police Plaza. This was egregious." I did not believe he would do it until we got down that morning, several hundred of us. Dave Dinkins got out the car with Charlie Rangel, walked to the front of One Police Plaza where he had been the mayor right across the street at City Hall, and got on a knee and went to jail, was cuffed, and went in a police van with us to stand up for an unarmed African immigrant. Here was the former mayor who had reached the pinnacle of power, but never stopped being an activist. He impacted my life, assuring me no matter how high you go, don't forget why you went, and don't forget to keep focused. Your integrity is more important than whatever rank you meet in life. That was Dave Dinkins. He didn't speak loud, but he did things that echoed around the world.
This is Congressman Adriano Spallan. David Dinkins is a national treasure, not just for New York City, not just for Harlem, but for the entire nation. Not only did he fight to get funding for community policing, not only did he fight to ensure that we had schools open until late evening for families through the Beacon program, but he was very important in bringing forward civility, bringing forward unity in our city at a crucial time in our history. He was someone that often referred to New York City as being a gorgeous mosaic. And he brought all sectors, all races, ethnic groups, religion together to ensure that we work for one city, one New York. We will always remember you, David Dinkins.
Mayor Dinkins was a class act. He was a friend of the theater and a friend of mine. He cared about making Times Square safe. His ideas like Restaurant Week and Fashion Week brought locals and tourists alike back to our neighborhood. He always made someone feel welcome. Given this honor, it's quite justified for such an outstanding New York citizen who cared deeply about this city. Mayor Dinkins, you were one of a kind, and you were very much missed. Thank you.
Whenever we were around Mayor Dinkins, he used to say that we, his speechwriters, made him sound smart. But the truth is, it was the other way around. Writing for Mayor Dinkins made us smart. Writing for him meant digging deep into what it meant to be a New Yorker, learning more about the history of our city, our communities, and the people he called our gorgeous mosaic. He valued people and their myriad perspectives. When he spoke, using expressions like, we are all temporarily able, we learned to put ourselves in other people's shoes and think about what their dreams were and what was standing in the way of those dreams. What I will never forget is the energy with which he embraced his work. I marveled at how he did so much. What was his secret? He found joy in it, all of it, even when it was difficult. He found joy in the people he crossed paths with, and he loved what he did every day. I have always been grateful for the experience of working for him, to witness that joy, to see someone like him putting his values in action. Having the opportunity to meet my soulmate, Bill, has made those times even more memorable. And I treasure the friendship he and his wife, Joyce, shared with us for so long. It's up to all of us now to carry on the lessons learned and his mission forward, to continue to make this city more fair with equity for all people. And we have no time to waste. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Michael J. Garner. I'm the MTA's Chief Diversity and Inclusion Officer, and I am a product of the Gang of Four. Let me say, years later, when I received a phone call from City Hall, they asked me if I wanted to speak at Mayor David Dinkins' 90th birthday party. I said, by all means. When I got there, it was a packed house, and I was one of only three speakers. It was the current mayor, Bill de Blasio, Mayor David Dinkins, and Mike Garner. Weeks later, I saw the mayor and I said, you know, when I spoke at your birthday party as one of three speakers, I knew that I had finally made it in the city of New York. The mayor looked and smiled and laughed. He said, you know, you made it a lot sooner as being someone in the city of New York, long before you spoke at my birthday party. That's the kind of class that Mayor David Norman Dinkins, the gentleman that he was. He always looked out for other people, and I'm just happy to be able to give a few comments at the service for our mayor, Mayor David Norman Dinkins.
All about service. The Honorable David N. Dinkins, as mayor of the city of New York, would famously remind us that service is the rent we pay for the privilege of living on this earth and that we stand on the shoulders of others. I had the privilege of serving with him in elected office as a member of the city council and receiving his support to become president of the borough of Manhattan. He led with courage, conviction, and compassion, and the far-reaching gains under his leadership, far too many to mention, continue as beacons of light for addressing matters confronting the nation and our city today, including community policing, health care, education, and so much more. Upon leaving public office, he did not stop, but sought opportunities to be a voice and a leader on international issues. So we celebrate the life and legacy of Mayor David N. Dinkins, knowing that he paid his rent in full and that we stand on his shoulders. And we shall always remember David N. Dinkins and his accomplishments.
Some years ago, I had the honor of sitting on the board of 100 Black Men when the legendary Tuskegee Airman and Professor Roscoe Brown was president. Tonight, I'm going to have the honor of bringing up the former president of 100 Black Men, who's going to give, in honor of David N. Dinkins, 4 scholarships. Ladies and gentlemen, the man who has more stripes, more suits with stripes and window panes, please give a big hand to Mr. Michael Garner.
Good evening. I'm gratified to be here this evening to honor our mayor, David Norman Dinkins. And as was formally stated, that the mayor loved children. When he became the mayor of the greatest city in the world, he had a concept called these after-school programs, the Beacon Programs, because he understood and he knew that you invest in your future, blacks and other students, because one day they may grow up to be Congressman Charlie Rangel, the chair of Ways and Means. And so all of our kids need growth, they need development, they need mentoring, and they need advice. And so, without further ado, we will be awarding these young black leaders $5,000 college scholarships on behalf of the Chamber, on behalf of the founding chapter of the 100 Black Men. So without further ado, each one of them are going to come up and introduce themselves.
Hello, everyone. My name is Gilbert Paschal. I'm a junior at NYU studying business management.
Hi, I'm Tiana Adams. I'm an incoming senior at the University of Scranton, and I'm a psychology major with a criminal justice minor and a legal studies concentration.
Good evening. My name is Akissa Sanders, and I'm going to be a senior at Ithaca College this summer, but I am a major in integrated marketing communications and a double minor in history and legal studies.
So on behalf of the Chamber and the founding chapter, 100 Black Men, can my great brothers stand up? This is a few of us. And also Congressman Charlie Rangel. And Congressman Greg Meeks, who is the only person who can beat me while wearing pinstripes and window panes. Thank you, brothers. I would like to now bring up a young gentleman from Impact. Who is going to give us a grant on behalf of the 100 Black Men.
Thank you from Impact Repertory Theater. Oh, my name is Malachi.
So once again, on behalf of the Chamber, the founding chapter of 100 Black Men, we are gratified to give you college scholarships to aid in your growth and development. And one day, we will be looking at you as our future great leaders that you are. Thank you very much.
Mayor Dinkins was an inspiration to me. I recall growing up in the 80s in Harlem and being able to look up to someone who I could identify with in his many roles, ultimately, obviously, ending with him as mayor of the city of New York. My mayor, someone from my neighborhood, someone who looked like me, who was an inspiration. I recall being a boy introduced to tennis by my dad, and it was my dad and Mayor Dinkins who made tennis cool for me. So not just the political impact, but also the personal impact. And as I sit here on the precipice of about to enter elected office, I think of Mayor Dinkins' oft-stated wise words about standing on the shoulders of greatness. And I know in a very profound and personal way that we would not be in this moment in our city without his work, his legacy, and the path that he blazed for me and for so many others. So I'm profoundly grateful to have seen him, to have grown up under his leadership, and to have benefited both growing up and even to this very day. Thank you.
Good evening. It's such a great honor to join you tonight as we remember David Dinkins. I had the great good fortune of meeting David Dinkins in 1989 when I was a young law student, the president of the Fordham Law School Democrats, and I invited David Dinkins, then running for mayor, to come to speak to the law school community. My father's law partners were Basil Patterson and Harold Dickies, and I don't remember if they actually helped me to get David Dinkins to come and speak, but I do remember his speech that day. I remember I was struck by the raw honesty of his speech when he talked about, among other things, his family being chased around by the landlords as a young boy. And you know, it was amazing to me to hear that speech at the time, because I always thought about speeches as being about, you know, soaring rhetoric and you know, big visions for the future. And here he was connecting with people on a personal level about his personal experiences in his life. I've always taken those lessons to heart from that speech back in 1989. Well, I followed David Dinkins carefully after that as he became the mayor. And I always remember he was, you know, he was so elegant. He wasn't flashy, he was elegant. And he was a grinder, just doing things one step at a time, not in, like I said, flashy ways, but just getting things done. And it was him that turned around New York City, that started the reduction in crime, that started the rebirth of housing, that brought the tennis stadium, as we all know. So many great accomplishments in his life. I went on to become a mayor and a county executive myself. And David Dinkins was always available for quiet advice, always greeting me warmly whenever I saw him. He invited me to come speak to his students up in Columbia. And it was such a great honor for him to invite me to come speak to try and teach young people. We can't forget also that David Dinkins was a Marine, a member of the storied Montfort Marines that received a Congressional Gold Medal, the only group along with the Tuskegee Airmen. I'm hoping to change that by getting a Congressional Gold Medal for the Harlem Hellfighters. But let's always remember David Dinkins as a man who served his country, who turned around the city of New York, and who helped the lives of millions of people. God bless you, David Dinkins.
Hi, this is Sally Hernandez Pinheiro. I was honored to serve as deputy borough president when David was Manhattan borough president, and as deputy mayor when he was mayor. I guess my favorite David Dinkins story We had a multi-trillion dollar budget deficit, and we spent hundreds of hours in the basement of Gracie Mansion going line by line over each item of the budget, hour after hour. And at the head of the table, with my three-year-old son in his lap, was Mayor Dinkins. And he sat peacefully as the mayor went through the budget. That's one of my great memories. He was always in touch with the side of him that connected to the most vulnerable, to children, to the needy. Yeah, I miss him. He was a very special man, and the city was lucky to have had him.
It was his dedication to public service, his dedication to the city of New York. His political approach was to bring out the best in people and to seek common ground. And that's something that obviously you don't see in abundance in today's political leaders. So it inspired me, and I believe it inspired all the members of his administration. I think that's a common thread that you'll find from most of the people who served with him, how dedicated he was to the greater good and how he never sought to divide.
I tell you, people really love David N. Dinkins. How about that? And this young man said when President Biden was elected, he said, it's a new day in America. From Congress, we have Mr. Gregory Meeks.
David Norman Dinkins, a man of grace and a man of elegance. The Gang of Four. Let me tell you something. I'm going to let out a secret that Chairman Rangel always lets out. I'm a graduate of UCLA. That degree means everything to me when you can graduate from UCLA. Everybody can't do it. Y'all know UCLA, right? The university at the corner of Lenox Avenue. I'm a graduate of that place. And learn more because of the Gang of Four, just watching them as a young child, how they worked together, how they thought differently at times, but together, how they planned, not for the short term, but the long term, which meant sometimes they had long-term gain for short-term pain. Some people today, we do it the other way. We get a short-term gain, but long-term pain. When I think of David Dinkins, I think of life's lessons. Lessons learned. Number one, he didn't run for office because he wanted an office to say that I am the borough president or the mayor of the city of New York. He ran because he cared about people and the plan that the gang had made, who was doing what. I saw Reverend Sharpton when he was leaving, and he said that he mentioned that my dear friend and former governor David Patterson, him and I, we used to be in a diner talking and planning and wanting to act like the Gang of Four. But what I want to just say in my brief time here is what I get most from David Dinkins. Number one, perseverance, determination, with quiet dignity. He ran for borough president. And when he lost, you didn't hear him calling people names and being angry and upset or anything of that nature. He continued to serve the community and plan and work. For me, there were, and I saw, and when I was listening to my friend Tom Suozzi, I was going to say and talk about a couple of things that he said on a consistent basis. But as a young black man watching and admiring and trying to grow up and understand how we can make this place that we call New York, this place, the United States, a better place, you got to be strong as an individual and respect. Now, number one, when you think about back then, the road really wasn't paved for people who were black and who were elected to anything or in business. They were the ones that had to pave the way so that Brian Benjamin and I and David Patterson would have a path to walk on. But there were certain things that David would say all the time that still lives with me today. Number one, just watching the relationship between him and Mrs. Dinkins. The respect that he always showed her. In fact, what always rings into my ear, you know, one of his speeches that he would give all the time, he says he was driving down the street and saw somebody that Joyce dated that was digging a ditch. And he looked at his wife and he says, see that old boyfriend? Ain't that your old boyfriend digging that ditch? Aren't you glad you married me? And she would say to him, if I had married him, you might be digging a ditch, he'd be the mayor. But that showed me the respect that he had and the love that he had for his wife and how you just watched how he treated his wife and women. Lesson learned. Lesson learned. He would see children and stop any place and talk to them. And I can remember one day in Far Rockaway, Queens, because one of the things that I knew when I was elected to the assembly in Far Rockaway, and we were able to bring a program in there for students, for young students, I knew there was only one person and only one name that center could have, and was the David Norman Dinkins Center for Cultural Advancement. And he would come and talk, and he was talking to this young lady. And the young lady was talking about how she was having difficulty in school with a particular teacher. And David said, I don't care about that teacher. You succeed anyway. Just focus on who you are. You can succeed. You succeed despite the teacher. Lesson learned. And then struggle. He always talked about how growing up, after coming to college and after getting married, he didn't have much money. And the bill collectors would come and say, and give him a lot of trouble. And he said he would figure it out. He said, look, give me a break. Because every month what I do, I take all my bills and I put them in a hat. And then I pull out who I can pay. And he says, you better be good to me because otherwise you won't get in the hat. Lesson learned, still be responsible. Days may be difficult, but if you hang in there and persevere, You can become mayor of the city of New York and do great things for people. I miss David Dinkins. I miss his leadership, his elegance. You know, y'all talking about Michael Garner. You never saw David Norman Dinkins unless he was dressed to the nines, no matter what he was doing. I can also say the same thing about the chairman, Charlie Rangel. You never see him. Percy Sutton, Basil Patterson. Those were examples that a young man in Harlem could look at and follow. So as I take my seat, some people preach a sermon. David Dinkins lived a sermon. And I thank God Almighty for making sure that David Dinkins, not only did he live, but he lived right here in New York, in Harlem, and was an example for us to follow. And history will record his greatness. And individuals who are successful only because David lived. God bless you.
Long time ago, it was a cold day in January at a UNCF breakfast for Martin Luther King Jr. I first met this man, and now he's here for a tribute to David N. Dinkins. He's the majority leader. He is a United States Senator. Please stomp your feet, put your hands together for a real fighter, for a real fighter. Senator Schumer.
Thank you, thank you. Charlie Rangel. We are fighting the fight. Charlie Rangel, my dear friend, mentor, leader, he taught me a lot, but he just did something I asked him to teach me and he never did. How to do his whistle. Go ahead, Charlie. Anyway, it is so wonderful, wonderful to be here, and I am so honored. Let me thank my dear friend, who's done such a great job as the president of the Greater Harlem Chamber of Commerce, Lloyd Williams. Ken Sunshine, who helped put this together. Charlie and Chuck, he taught me so much. Looks pretty good with that beard. But Charlie, it's just lovely and wonderful and invigorating to see you. I got my two fellow Brooklynites who were both here, Eric Adams and Reverend Al Sharpton. Hazel Duke, she never stops going. She's the Energizer Buddy. Keith Wright is here. David Patterson, my nickname for him is Dovital, which means dear little David. Michael Garner, Gail Brewer, so many others. And I just want to say one other thing, a little bit of pride in my wife, as David had pride in Joyce. It's just amazing to be here at this great Schomburg Center for Research. What a fitting place to celebrate the life of one of the greatest Black New Yorkers, one of the greatest New Yorkers in our city's long history. And my wife, who works for the library, had a good hand in this beautiful renovation of the Schomburg Center. So I'm proud of her. Well, let me just say, David It was just a year after Arturo Alfonso Schomburg sold his vast personal collection of African-American literature to the New York Public Library in 1927 that across New York Bay, in Trenton, New Jersey, a son was born, to Sally and William Dinkins. His name was David. As a young boy, David lived in Harlem. He soaked up the vibrancy and vitality of the community before returning to Trenton to graduate high school. Not content to sit on the sidelines when his nation was still fighting Japan overseas, David joined the Army and then the Montfort Point Marines. The first of so many occasions when David would choose serving the public over himself. That was one of his hallmarks. He always put the public ahead of himself. And even at that young age, he was willing to put his life on the line for a nation that treated him like a second-class citizen. Why would he do that? What inspired him to make that sacrifice? To help answer that question, I turn to the amazing words of another great New Yorker, that great Bard of Harlem, Langston Hughes, who wrote these words while David was exploring 125th Street as a child, and I quote, "Oh yes, I say it plain, America was never America to me, and yet I swear this oath, America will be." David Dinkins swore that oath every single day of his life. That by dint of hard work and talent and faith and decency, America could be brought a little bit closer to fulfilling its promise of its awesome and inspiring founding principles. David was a great mayor for so many reasons. Many of them have been mentioned here, both in person and video. But above all, he was a great mayor. He was a great man because he never wavered from his values, never. Values that were forged like iron at Camp Lejeune alongside his fellow soldiers. That was why one of the proudest moments of my life that I recall every week was when I helped lead the charge to pass the bill in the United States Congress to give those Montfort Point Marines the Congressional Gold Medal and be there for the ceremony when the medal was placed on the chest of Mayor David Dinkins with his wonderful and elegant wife Joyce right by his side. And, as mentioned, I'm proud to share at long last, because it's happening tomorrow. The 369th Infantry Regiment, the Harlem Hellfighters, are finally going to get the recognition they deserve from the federal government. Along with Senator Gillibrand, we got this bill through the Senate. Tomorrow, I will be, and everyone's welcome to join us, at the 369th Armory with some of the families of those brave heroes and members of the 369th to celebrate. And guess who will be there smiling from above? David Norman Dinkins. Now, folks, more than ever in this world with such nasty things happening, some leadership so lacking for the last 4 years, I couldn't avoid giving a dig at him. I hate that guy. We need leaders like David Dinkins to remind us what America can and should be. The gorgeous mosaic of race and religious faith, of national origin and sexual orientation, his words, where those who have been oppressed and abused for generations finally receive the full rights and dignity of the whole. David got a lot of grief for what he tried to achieve as mayor, and yet he did everything sticking to his values with grace, with dignity, and often with a smile. Even when he was angry, his voice was soft. And he had reason to be angry what had been done to him and to our city. I miss him. Our city misses him. But we can all take strength from his memory and legacy as we confront the many challenges that face our city and our nation in the days and weeks to come. Thank you, David. Thank you for inspiring us. Thank you, everybody.
nobody gets anywhere alone. Everybody stands on somebody's shoulders. And I love to tell the story of a kid in the fifth grade, and there's a turtle 8-10 feet high on a fence post. And the teacher says, well, now what is it you know? What does that say to you? And the little boy said, well, I know one thing. He didn't get there by himself.
I see New York as a gorgeous mosaic of race and religious faith, of national origin and sexual orientation, of individuals whose families arrived yesterday and generations ago. In that spirit, I offer this fundamental pledge. I intend to be the mayor of all the people of New York.
Born in Trenton, New Jersey, to Sarah Sally Lucy and William Harvey Dinkins Jr., his family was no stranger to hard work. His dad was a barber and real estate agent, his mom a domestic worker. At the age of 7, he found his first hustle.
As a matter of fact, when I was about 8 or 9 years old, at 125th and 8th Avenue at the intersection there, they had push carts from which they sold fruit and vegetables. But they wouldn't give you a shopping bag, you had to buy one. So I used to buy them 3-4 nickel and sell them 2 cents a piece. When I finally got together 10 cents and went and bought something for my mother, I was the proudest little guy you ever saw.
He held odd jobs throughout high school, including working at the post office. He became one of the first black recruits known as the Montford Point Marines, serving from 1945 to 1946.
The war's going on, you see. And I wanted to enlist in the Marine Corps because I figured, see, people you knew were dying. I mean, the cat that lived across the street around the corner were dying. I mean, this is really smack dab in the middle of the war. And so I figured the best way to increase my chances of survival would be well trained, which means be a Marine.
You know, he was proud that he had been a Marine. Right, and Marines are tough. That's what he used to say, you know, Marines are tough.
He was a Marine and he loved being a Marine.
He never considered college, but the GI Bill and a push from his stepmother landed him at the prestigious Howard University.
Howard was really Harvard in his viewpoint. It was nothing that could compare the experience that he had at Howard and with his roommate Andy Young. What they had for lunch, sometime their lunch and dinner was the same thing, because that's how poor they was. And then when he saw Joyce on campus, this beautiful girl coming, and of course, she was kind of from a middle class family in New York. And so she sometimes would give him a crust of bread, he would say.
They were married in 1953 and moved in with his in-laws.
Oh my God, it was like a marriage in heaven, even after their 60 some years. Being together, you thought it was love at first sight.
People didn't realize Joyce is the reason David got into New York politics. It's her father, Danny Burroughs, was an assemblyman and a real power in Harlem. And he was one of the mentors for that generation of the Rangel, Sutton, Patterson, Dinkins world.
Encouraged by Mr. Burroughs, he attended Brooklyn Law School working nights in his liquor store until he graduated in 1956.
When I came out of law school, I went with Fritz Alexander, Tom Dyett, who was the dean of black lawyers. And later I joined a law firm with Basil Patterson, Patterson, Michael, Dinkins, and Jones. And in fact, for a while we had offices at 2097th Avenue, If that dress sounds familiar to you, it should, because it's where the hotel is. So that's where, when I got to the point where I could give up my night job, because I had a night job all through law school, and then for 2 years after that, I put on a shirt and tie and go down to the law office. But at night, I went to the liquor store where I worked. When I got to the point where I give up the liquor store, I joined a political club. I had no interest in seeking public office until one day Ray Jones, first black head of Tammany Hall. And he said to me, "Boy, you want to run for the assembly?" I said, "I don't know, I guess." That's how it started. But once it was a 1 year term. And then the next year I was a delegate to the Constitutional Convention. And after that, I was hopelessly hooked on public service.
And it was clear that Ray Jones, that he was Ray Jones' fairhead successor. And of course, Ray Jones had some obligations to me. He buried the hatchet with Percy Sutton. Basil Patterson was a leader in the NAACP. We enjoyed each other so much. And really, we guess we were a gang of four people who had our own paths, had no obligations to any organizations, that worked so well together and had no conflict. And out of that was the gentleman of the whole group, David Dinkins.
So I ran for borough president. In fact, I ran three times before I succeeded. And people used to say to me, "What do you do?" I say, "I run for borough president."
In his 10 years of service, his favorite part was presiding over the city's marriage bureau. When due to stigma, no clerk wanted to marry a hospitalized man with AIDS, he chose to perform the ceremony himself.
Of course, Koch in those days was a liberal, progressive member of the city council and of the Congress. It wasn't until his third term that we felt he'd move more and more to the right, and we needed somebody to run against him. And it happened to be my lot.
Dinkins beat incumbent Mayor Ed Koch, incumbent controller Jay Golden, who was a smart guy, and Dick Ravitch, a very successful and a business person and a real intellectual power in the Democratic Party. The four of them ran against each other for the Democratic primary for mayor in 1989.
And the conventional wisdom was that we wouldn't win, because even if I finished first, there was no way was I going to get 40% with four of us running. And then in a runoff, because each of the others was Jewish, they'd gang up on me and I would lose. Well, we got 51%.
And then took on the Republican, Rudolph Giuliani. You know, electing the first black mayor of New York, it seems like some historic thing now. I mean, what was the big deal? It was a big deal. And it was a big deal to get white people to vote for a black person. Simple as that. You needed to get the more moderate and certainly liberal Jews and other white New Yorkers to feel very comfortable about voting for David Dinkins. Well, we did it, and we did it largely because David Dinkins was a masterful politician.
Publicly, he was courteous and charming, a polished gentleman. This was tempered by his private irritability, curtness, anger, and a wicked sense of humor.
One of the things about Mayor Dinkins that people mistake, because he was very genteel and he was polite, way more polite than most people are in this era, and he had a kind way, they thought he wasn't tough. He was one tough son of a bitch.
But he had the ability to control it in circumstances that, quite frankly, I would get more annoyed than he. I had a list of people that didn't support him, for mayor, who didn't support him for borough president. But he didn't have a list. I had the list. And he used to really annoy me how quickly he would forget people who had not been trustworthy.
He always stayed calm and highlight attention when I know that he should have jumped up and slapped people or gave them a hard punch. He kept his demeanor as a professional, calm, cool, and polite. And that took a lot of inner strength that showed the human that he was.
It's very interesting talking about his dignified way. Part of it was a generation. You know, African-American men of a certain generation, I think, were trying very hard to be formal in their way of presenting themselves to a often very hostile white world. And I mean, I'm simplifying, you know, it didn't apply to everybody and all, but he was really formal in the way he dressed, in the way he conducted himself, in his use of language. He was very precise in his use of language. And it was him. Believe me, it was not put on.
In his time, Dinkins never got true credit for all of his accomplishments as mayor.
Crime was a big problem in New York in the 80s. And it was out of control. And you elect the first black mayor, a skeptical white press is going to say, oh, this guy is going to not be as sensitive to the crime issue. Totally the reverse.
Dinkins appointed Lee Brown, who was an African-American, as police commissioner, who did a great job in strengthening the relationship between all the communities, and especially the African-Americans community.
And he got monies in Albany that were specifically designed to combat crime, and Giuliani gets all the credit for crime going down in New York. It started under Dinkins, and that is a major accomplishment.
I did that program, Safe Streets, Safe City. It came under me as president of New York City All-Track Betting. And this was a safe city under Dinkins' administration. He did great work. He had beacon schools for our children. He cared about children. He cared about education. He cared about seniors. He talked about the vulnerable people.
I couldn't pinpoint any one thing that we did singly, but I think that the bright light of the Apollo coming back on 125th Street with the empowerment zone, with Dinkins being the mayor, with Percy being this spearheader on the Apollo and so many other things, with Basil paving the way to Albany, wherever he went, and even as deputy mayor, it's not so much really what you do when you're in office, but how many ties and friendships did you build during that particular period that you were in office. And as David would say, we had a real mosaic of people and themes and ideas that would just fit in whenever the opportunity would come.
He was a hard worker. You could find Mayor Dinkins in his office at 6 o'clock in the morning, 11 o'clock at night. But once in a while, he would put on his tennis clothes and go and play tennis. And so they made a big thing out of that. It was, he didn't take vacations. He didn't have a private plane that he could fly to Bermuda, where he had at home in Bermuda, one in Hawaii. He didn't have that. But even the kind of luxury that he liked, the pleasure of playing tennis, they made a big deal, front page story.
He loved tennis, and building that stadium that we have here, the Arthur Ashe Theater, a tennis stadium, That brings in more revenue than all of his sport events in the city of New York. And he was able to do it with strong opposition from Giuliani. But yes, he loved tennis, and tennis loved him.
When you went with Mayor Dinkins to the presidential box, this is not like liberal Democratic presidential box. This is the US Open. So this is green pants and bow ties, and let's just say a lot of it wasn't my crowd, but it was his crowd. He would love that world. So I would kid him about it all the time. I said, well, we didn't get any votes in this box, Mr. Mayor. He said, shut up. He said, you know, this is, you got your thing, this is my thing.
Mandela, at that time, his wife was Winnie Mandela. And they came and they stayed at Gracie Mansion. Bill Lynch put that together. That was a great time for New York City, the world and the state. The city was with pride. I mean, black and white showed so much love for the city and for a man who had endured so much. And what Mandela meant to David, to the mayor, to show the strength that these men had above adversity in their lives and what people tried to do to them.
First place to which he came upon release from prison outside of Africa was to New York. And I owe it to Bill Lynch that he just would not quit, and we got him here. And one of my favorite photographs, which is probably around here somewhere, it's got Madiba, there it is right there. Madiba holding our granddaughter. Oh, he was a remarkable man, oh God. When they asked me, and as I'm sure you probably are asked this, with whom would you most like to have dinner? Who would you most like to meet, of living or dead, of the people in the past? And I always, very easy choice for me, Nelson Mandela. Everywhere is
war. There was the incident that had happened in Brooklyn. That was before the Cato, the running over of the child, before that riot happened. It was another incident had happened in Brooklyn. And as you know, Giuliani brought the cops to storm City Hall when Mr. Dinkins was mayor. He said that Dinkins didn't back up the police department. And so he had the police to rally the PBA group against the mayor. They came and said he had to go, and they stormed City Hall. They were on top of cars, just ugly, kind of for a city of a man who was always looking to bring the community together.
The Crown Heights riots were a defining moment in his career. In the spirit of the Mosaic, he attempted healing and reconciliation for both the Black and Jewish communities, but neither side thought he went far enough or responded fast enough to appease them. Many believe it's what cost him the re-election.
We were devastated when he lost the election because he had given so much to this city, and there was so much more for him to do. But he took it like a champ. He never showed any anger against the city, against those who voted against him. He treated Giuliani with courtesy. He made sure the transition was smooth for Giuliani. And so we were just heart-sickened that we had a gentleman, a man who loved the city, to be defeated, one, because of racism, and two, because of the, what you see today of the Trumpism, that's what Giuliani had always been.
And when he was first defeated by Giuliani,
the press was still pretty ugly toward him, and there was not as much warmth about him. But as time went on, and Dinkins was still a very public person and a dignified person, the image of Dinkins changed. And I think there was much greater respect toward Dinkins and his administration. And I'm very grateful for that. And those of us, you know, close loyalists and family are gratified that the Dinkins place in history is a respected one more and more, and a pioneering one. I mean, to be blunt, being the first black mayor of New York was a big deal. And to quote Reverend Sharpton, without a David Dinkins, there would have been no Barack Obama.
Well, I think that his speech, when he made it clear that mayors come and go, but the city goes on forward, he loved this town. He loved flying in and looking at the lights sparkling like diamonds. He was hooked on his people and the different cultures that we've had. And honestly, he thought that the honor that he had to represent all of these dreams, especially for people of African descent, and to bring them together, that just serving and not winning the second term, but just serving, was the height of his lifetime ambition. And so while I would never really know the personal feeling that he had with his loss, you would never know it if you were talking to him. He loved the city more than he loved himself.
But one day there'll be another black, and it'll be a woman. We've never had a woman who was mayor. See, but we not just blacks, but society generally is illogical. I mean, if you think that women couldn't even vote until around 1920, that's just plain stupid. And my undergraduate degree is in mathematics, and I'm a lawyer, and always at the top of the class for women. It's no love, it's the walk
to freedom. There was so much more to David Dinkins than the title of first black mayor. He was a husband, a father, a powerhouse, a legacy. He is part of Harlem's legacy, New York City's legacy. Our legacy.
For the children of this city are voices of hope, singing out the sweet songs of the future amidst the discord of daily life. They sing in Spanish and English, Russian and Italian, Korean and Creole, all the dozens of languages we speak in our town. The spirit of their youth says to each of us, follow your hopes and not your fears. And to them, and to each of you, I make this promise. The same one I made when I entered the United States Marine Corps. Semper Fidelis, always faithful. Thank you, God bless you. Keep the faith.
The other thing about David Dinkins, he was so funny. People thought because he was formal and somewhat dignified in his manner that he wasn't funny.
Dave had a real great sense of humor, albeit it was dry humor.
He could tell some jokes wasn't even funny, but when he made them, you ever heard him tell a story about he was riding a limousine with Mrs. Dinkins?
My bride and I are riding along in the city limousine when I was mayor. This is the days when the mayors used big, long vehicles. And
there was some fellow out there that was repairing a ditch that was adjacent to the mansion.
And she saw the man shoveling the gravel or the dirt, and he looked out the window and he said, "See Joyce?"
Isn't that fella digging the ditch? Isn't he somebody that you used to date? And he said that Joyce looked over and said, "Yes, that is someone I used to date."
I said, "See, if you'd married him, you'd be wife of a ditch digger." She said, "No, if I'd married him, he'd be mayor."
Plasmatic, I freak beat, slam it like Iron Sheik, jam like a tech with correct techniques, so analyze me, surprise me, but can't magnetize me, scanning while you're planning ways to sabotage me, I leave them froze like Ezron in your nose, Nas a Rockwell, it ain't hard to tell.
You know, Debbie, I was riding with David in limousine one time, and believe it or not, he told me that joke, too.
I tell you, we all love him. He was a wonderful man, wasn't he? David Dinkins. And now, we have the Lion of Harlem coming up, huh?
The Lion of Harlem, that's correct. Still roaring to this day.
And the last member of the Gang of Four.
Ladies and gentlemen, you gotta put your hands together. You gotta give us a big, big, big auditorium filled applause for
Charles Bernard Rangel.
Come on, that's not enough hand to put in the glove. Come on, that's more hands, come on.
Hold on. The hour is so very, very, very late. But I really want to thank Lloyd Williams and Bulger Rivers, because when the Dinkins family decided, because of the virus, to have a private funeral, we in Harlem were so concerned that so many people would never get a chance to say so long to our prince. And when Lloyd suggested that what could be a better tribute than Harlem Week, I could not think of any group that's just more professional in making this great village, its reputation, and where it has been and where it's going, than Lloyd Williams and the Chamber of Commerce. So Lloyd, you and Bosa Rivers and Mr. Joseph, who did the filming, so many people that we don't know their faces came together and did a fantastic job. And it reaches the point that everything that has to be said about my brother, my friend, my buddy, my has already been said by so many, many people. And the most important thing for us to remember, in my opinion, about David, and it was said so many different ways, is that I never did understand that turtle joke, but in his way, he was trying to say everybody needs somebody to help them. And he talked about Percy Sutton and Jesse Jackson, Adam Clayton Powell, and all the other people and their struggles never would become recognized. But as Chairman Meeks said, they carved a path so that he would be able to make all of us here and black folks all over the world so proud. And he said the same thing, including every funeral he went to, that he thought he heard somewhere that God would charge you rent for your time on earth, and that it was good deeds was the rent you had to pay. And he would say that the person who left had paid his rent or her rent in full, and that we should never be behind. Well, that's the thought he is giving, but Hazel, we are going through a reconstruction that this country has never been through. And we're not talking about Patterson and Sutton and Rangel and Dinkins. We're talking about people who gave up their lives to fight for our freedom, that we don't even know their names. We don't even look like them. We don't know the culture. We don't know where we came from, the songs, the history. And yet, as Donald Trump so wisely saw, white preference is not going to be what's going to keep this country together. And as we look at the complexions of people throughout this world and see who the threat is to the United States of America, it's abundantly clear that if we don't eradicate the cancer of racism, there will be no United States of America. And so it's the memories that all of you have in remembering that we would not be here unless someone made the sacrifice. And all of us have the ability to do something that's a little different, even if you exaggerate when you tell it to your children and your grandchildren. Exaggeration is not that bad. If you're encouraging somebody to do the right thing. And Dave Dinkins has shown what the child of a domestic worker and a barber from, of all places, Trenton, can do for our city, for our community, our city, and our country. And that's a debt that we all have. And so all I can say, and I know Hazel agrees, is that we have a hell of a job to do. And don't be angry with Trump. It's kind of hard for you to understand that. But if it had not been for Donald Trump coming out and showing the depth of the hate that we have in this country, I can tell you, I'm 91 years old, I have never really met a white Southerner in Harlem or in New York. It was only until I went into the Army and went South that I could see how precious white preference was to people in this country who said, I challenge you to take that away from me. And when you see the chairman of the Foreign Affairs Committee, you have no idea of the international power that Gregory Meeks holds. So we have, our leaders are there, and Dave Dinkins has shown that you don't have to be a guy from Lenox Avenue like me, that we can produce class like David Dinkins did. And a little bit of that, it's hard to find it in me, but we all have a little bit of it to let the world know that we remember David Dinkins, we're thankful for him, and again, to the chamber and to all of us that made this wonderful evening. What a gift they've given to us this evening. Long, but a wonderful, wonderful gift. So Inez, the baton is being passed to you. Thank you.
Hey. Okay. I love Charlie Rangel. First of all, let me just thank you all for coming. When we looked at the COVID variant and what was happening, and speaking to Joy and to Kevin at Schomburg, we tried to figure out whether we really do this. We turned away over 250 people because we wanted there to be space. And I hope you'll pass the word to those we turned away what you saw tonight. I want to acknowledge Hazel, who is my sis. Eric Adams, Gail Brewer, Robert Jackson, Alvin Bragg, Greg Meeks, Adriano Espiot, David Patterson, Al Sharpton, and so many others for coming out tonight. Let me just say to this extraordinary guy, Jamal Joseph, and he came in the door at that moment. Jamal, thank you for, in 2 weeks, putting together that 20-minute film tribute. Stand up, Jamal. Thank you. A gorgeous mosaic. When each of you leave, we're going to give you a historic keepsake. Each of you. You're going to get a 16-page historic walk through the life of David Dinkins. Okay? And you'll get that as you're leaving. I want to thank, Charlie Rangel speaks about his brother, David. I have my blood brother, Ronnie, with me. Ronnie, love you much. I have my son, Latif Ade, I adore you. And those of you who know me know that my feelings for my wife, Valerie, I think she's it. I, though, joined with Charlie Rangel, who loves his brother, David Dinkins, to love my brother, Voza Rivers. Okay? And Voza, you're gonna hold up people. You're not gonna like me calling you out, but I'm doing it anyway. So just come on out. You can take all the time you want and hold up the program, or you can come on out, okay? Okay. Hey, this man, history books will be writing about this man, and I'm just honored to have him as my brother. I'll close by thanking the chairpersons, and when you go out in that 16-page program, they'll have all of the chairpersons, and they will have all of the sponsors. You know, I think sometimes when we talk about the Gang of Four, at St. Martin's Church, when we were little children, we had this Gang of Four, and one it was here, Voza Rivers, and the other is Dr. Enrique Riggs, and the other was Ronnie Williams. That was we didn't know we were a gang. We just thought we were a gang. You know, what the hell? You know? Thank you, Schomburg, for opening up this extraordinary Institute of Higher Education, Culture, and Learning. Everybody, let's find a way to support Schomburg. And our closing piece is to ask our brother, he's my little brother, he's the publisher of the New York Christian Times, Reverend Dennis Dillon, if he would just let us depart with some inspirational words. Reverend Dennis Dillon.
Thank you. Can we put our hands together for our president, Lord Williams? Can we do this standing? If everybody would just stand. I just want to end by saying that all that has been said tonight about the late Honorable David N. Dinkins is just the frosting on the cake. It is important that we understand that English isn't adequate to really, truly explain and describe the legacy and the greatness of David Dinkins. We could use the word goodness. We could say decency. We can say wisdom, humility, love, integrity, strength, fortitude, and the list goes on and on and on. If David Dinkins was laid before us tonight, I would say here lives and lies a life that can never die. It is important that we understand that death can take his life, but death can't take away the legacy. Death is able to take from us our precious moments with him, but death cannot take away our cherished memories of him. I want to just say that in 1991, a young lady by the name of Anne Marie Huntley walked into the Christian Times office. She was the director of the All City High School Choir. They were on a trip to Spain. These young people in our public school system were on their way to Spain. They needed to raise $87,000. They were about $67,000 short. We got the word out through the Christian Times. After about 2 or 3 weeks, we raised an additional $20,000. They were very short. She came back and I said, listen, we got to go and talk to Mayor Dinkins. And I took her over to City Hall and we journeyed into Mayor Dinkins' office. And I said, Mayor, the young people are trying to get to Spain for the All City Festival, but they lack the resources and the capacity. And he took me into the office of Joyce Brown along with Miss Huntley, and in 2 weeks, the mayor raised the $67,000 that the children needed in order to get to Spain. That is Mayor David Dinkins. So as we go from here, I want to end by saying this to us. It is important that we understand that the life, the energy, the will, the legacy of David N. Dinkins must not be the exception, it must be the example. So each of us have a responsibility to walk out of here tonight with a commitment even greater that we will let this legacy live on and we will truly be the examples of what David Dinkins was. God bless you. I praise peace upon you. I decree blessings and I decree prosperity. In God's name, amen.
Stay with me. Closing. Harlem Week, 47th anniversary. Our theme this year, as we reimagine Harlem Week in this now virtual and live format, our theme is rebirth, rebuild, and rejoice. And so we're going to rejoice together. We invite you, of course, to come out on this Saturday on West 135th Street from Malcolm X Boulevard over to St. Nicholas Avenue as we celebrate Harlem Week. And we begin Saturday with the Harlem 5K Run, which is a tribute this year to David Dinkins. And we are honoring people like Chadwick Boseman and so many others. On Sunday, Harlem Day, we pay tribute to Cecily Tyson. And we invite you to come out for our Children's Festival at Schaumburg on Saturday, 2 p.m. right here. We're going to do our spelling bee, our Children's Spelling Bee. And this year, it will be a tribute to Alex Trebek. You may not know Alex Trebek has Harlem roots. His family here, and they own businesses here, and he's always been a supporter. So, by the way, this entire program is going to be live streamed on Sunday at harlemweek.com. And so you'll be able to see what happened outside and what happened with Eric Adams and the interviews and everything else that Tony Rogers and team have put together. Let me then close by asking if Ms. Debbie B. And G. Keith Alexander would just come and join us, please. Please. This way. Many of you know G. Keith Alexander and Debbie B. I thank them so much for taking time out of their busy schedules to serve as MC. Let me just say, for any of you who do not remember, that this beautiful woman, her husband was the great Hal Jackson, okay? And we are proud that she is a board member of Harlem Week. So as you leave, let me just thank you. And I'm gonna say something, and I just want you to hear it. The people in this room right now, at this moment, everyone here will never, ever, ever, ever be in the same space again. Something is going to happen. We're going to move. We're going to get sick. So many things might happen. And so this is a moment that God has sent. Okay? And I just ask you, when you're going out, to touch the person next to you, to say hello, to introduce yourself, because that person who you're talking to now, you may never, ever see again in their life or your life. Let us not lose that opportunity to honor each other and to honor David Dinkins. And I thank you on behalf of the Greater Harlem Chamber of Commerce, but more importantly, on the Village of Harlem, for coming out tonight as we determined that we would not let David Dinkins just dissipate, that we were going to honor him in the Harlem community, and thank you for joining us. I hope you all have a good night and enjoy yourself as you're leaving and get the commemorative program. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Lloyd. You want the Christian Times is out front if they want to take it with a tribute to David.
There's a, I'm sorry, there's a tribute to David Dinkins in the Christian Times as you're leaving. Please take a copy with you.